Hello everyone, Bill P is here once again. Welcome back to my channel. If you are new, if you are watching us for the first time, I say a very big welcome to you. Or if you are a returning subscriber, I say a thank you to you at the same time. But in any case, I will implore you, if you have not subscribed, to please subscribe to this channel and then go home after the subscription button and hit the notification bell as well. And please do not stop at that. Also go up, move over to the like button and give a thumbs up to this this video, so that we can quickly hit the 1,000 subscribers target for the YouTube algorithm. All right, now the last class we did equivalent fraction, where I introduced you to what equivalent fractions are. So basically, equivalent fractions are fractions that come in different numerators and denominators, and at the same time they are what, equal to one another, they are the same thing. Do you understand? I'll give you an instance. 3/9, for instance, is the same thing as 1/3, although they come in different numerators and denominators, but at the same time they are equal to what, to each other. So today's class we'll be looking at what, ordering of what, fractions, how we can order our word fraction. Is it, we want to know if you have a set of fractions, for instance, we want to know how you can detect the one that is what, the highest number, the highest fraction, or the smallest fraction. And there are some cases they will give you sets of fractions and they will ask you to rearrange them from ascending order. Ascending order means you start from the smallest one to the biggest one. But if you're asked to arrange in descending order, it means you start from the biggest one and then you work your way down to the what, to the smallest one. Alright, but before we proceed on that, don't forget to subscribe, hit the notification bell, contact me via the give a beautiful comment as to whether or not you enjoy this this content, you know, and then give this video a thumbs up. Now, before we proceed to ordering of fractions, there are three underlying rules that we want us to first of all establish and to understand before we can move on to subsequent ordering of what, fractions. Now let's take them one by one. Now the first one is this: if the denominators are the same, then the largest fraction is the one with the largest numerator. What do I mean by that? If you have a set of what, fractions like this, I need to decide which of this fraction is the largest, which of this fraction is the smallest. Now, they're now telling us that if you have the same, if the denominators are the same, if you look at the denominator, they are 6, 6, 6, 6. Mean that in this set of fractions, we have what, the denominators to build the same. Now, in this case, it's a rule, actually, that if you have a set of fractions with the same denominator, then if you want to now decide the one that is the largest fraction among all of them, it should be the one that has the largest what, numerator. Now in this one, now if you look at this, we have 2/6, 4/6, 1/6, and then 5/6. So which means, which of this one is the largest fraction? This 5/6 will be our largest fraction. Why? Because it is the one that has the numerator with the largest number. You can see that this is 5, this is 1, this is 4, and this is 2. So please, before you can just decide that, oh, a fraction with the largest numerator is the largest number, it has to mean that every other fraction in that given set of fractions, that was, they have the same denominator. Does that make sense to you? Alright. Now let's go to the second rule. The second rule is this: if the numerators, all the numerators, if they are the same, then the smallest fraction is the one with the largest what, denominator. What do I mean by that? I have series of fractions here. And you can see that their numerators are the same. That is, I have 2 as a numerator, as opposed to this one, that is the denominator that are what, are the same. So here, I have the numerator, that is the number that is up to be the same, which is what? 2, 2, 2, and 2. Now in this case, if you have the numerators, all of them, they are the same. That means the smallest fraction here will be the fraction that has what, the largest denominator. Because if you look at the denominator, that is the number that is down, you can see that we have 3 as a denominator here, we have 4 as a denominator here, we have 7 as a denominator here, and we have 8 as a denominator here. So basically, the fact that you have the same numerators, now, the smallest of this fraction will now be the one that has the largest denominator. Does that make sense? So you can see, it's more or less like a opposite of this. So please, do not mix them up. Take your time to study the differences between both of them. When you have the denominator, they are the same. The one that has the highest numerator is the largest fraction among the sets. But if you have the same numerator, the one that has the largest denominator becomes what? The smallest fraction among the given sets. Does that make sense to you? Alright. Now let's look at the third rule. Now if the numerators and denominators are different entirely, take for instance 3/5, 2/7, 1/6, like 3 over 4, and so on and so forth. You can see that the numerator are not the same. Even the denominator are not the same. So what do? In this case, you have to convert them towards equivalent fraction. After which you convert them to equivalent fraction, you'll now be able to decide that, oh, that this is the largest or this is the smallest. Now, I'm going to teach you how to convert towards equivalent fraction. Now, let's look at this following example to actually see how we can follow example so that we can understand this concept better. Explain the concept that we have treated before. Don't forget, I told you that in order for us to order fractions, we can order fraction based on the fact that if they have the same denominator, there's something we can do. We have the same numerator, there's another thing we can do. But if both the denominator and the numerator are not the same, so that means what do we do? In that case, we have to convert them towards equivalent fraction. So which means, this example I have here, you can see that both 7 over 8 and 3 over 4, none of the numerator or the denominator are the same in any way. You can see that the numerator of this one is 7 and this one is what, 3. At the same time, the denominator of this is 8, while that of this one is what, 4. So you can see they are not the same. So what do? We need to change them towards equivalent fraction. We need to look for a number with which we can multiply this with, such that we can arrive at the same words, either the same denominator or the same numerator. Now, you can pick anyone. I want to pick the denominator. I want to make this 8 and this 4. I want to look at this 8 and this 4, these two denominators, and look for a number such that if I use that number to multiply the two of them, I'll arrive at either 8, 8. I'll arrive at 8, 8. Do you understand? Now, let's look at this. I have 7 over 8. And I also have what? 3 over 4. Now, what can I do to this 4 here and this 8 that will make them to be the same? Now, what can I do to 8 that will make 8 to still remain 8? What can I use to 4 that will make 4 to be 8? Because the goal here, actually, if you are converting to equivalent fraction, you either want to make your denominator to be the same or you want to make your numerator to be the same. So, me, I've decided to make my own denominator to be the same. If possible, you can use your numerator, but in this numerator, I prefer to use the denominator anyway to make it easier for me. In other instances, it might be that it's the numerator that I'm going to work on. Now, but today, I want to use the denominator. I want to make sure that these two denominators, I want to arrive at the same thing with the denominator. Now, if I look at this 8 here, and I look at this 4, I need to ask myself now, what kind of number can I come up with such that if I multiply these two, I will arrive at either 80 and 80 or any other number that both of them are going to be worth the same thing. Now, when I look at 8, I realize that, oh, for me to have 80, it can multiply with another number. So that means I can multiply with what? 1. So that means I can say this one times 1, this one 2 times 1. Then this one, how can I make this one to be like this 8 exactly if I multiply? So that means I can multiply this with what? 2. Because I know that 4 times 2 will be the same 8. So this will be what? Times 2. And please, the fact that I want to work with this 2 denominator, whatever it is that I use to multiply this denominator here, is the same number I have to use to multiply the numerator. Just like whatever number I use to multiply this denominator, which is 4 here, is the same number I'm supposed to use to multiply this numerator. Does that make sense? All right. Now, the fact that I want this my 4 to be equivalent to 8, I need to ask myself, how do I do it? So I'll say, oh, if I take 2 and multiply 4 with this 2, I should have 8. The same way, if I say 8 times 1, I should still have 8. Meaning that this 8 times 1 will give me 8, and 4 times 2 will give me the same 8. So this is what I have at the end of the day. 7 times 1 is what? 7. 8 times 1 is what? 8. 3 times 2 is what? 6. 4 times 2 is what? 8. So you can see that I have been able to successfully change this denominator and this. Alright. So, now you can see that I have successfully make this denominator to be 8, as well as this one to be what? 8. Now, I've been able to change this. This one is now what? The same 7 over 8 that it was originally, while this 3 over 4 has changed to what? 6 over 8. Now, the first rule states that, how do we know the fraction that is now larger among these two now? So, for us to know the one that is larger or smaller among these two, look at their denominator. They are the same. Now, the first rule that I shared with you in the previous lesson before this example was the fact that if they have the same denominator, then the one that has the larger number becomes the larger fraction. You just Once you have the same denominator, you just treat them as number, meaning that, oh, the larger number becomes the larger what? Fraction. Does that make sense? Now, that means this 7 over 8 becomes what? The larger fraction. Now, if this is not the larger fraction, so what are we now going to put in this our box? Is it greater than or less than? What do we put there? That means I'm going to put what? Greater than. Why? Because 7 over 8 is greater than what? 3 over 4. Does that make sense? All right. So you can see that you cannot just say, you cannot just think out of the blue and say 7 over 8 is larger than 3 over 4. No, it's not possible. You need to convert them towards equivalent fraction first. From there, you now know, oh, if it is larger or not. Don't forget, how do we know the larger number is the fact that they have the same denominator. Now, the fact that they have the same denominator, it means that the one that has the bigger what? Numerator is what? The bigger fraction. Does that make sense? All right. Now, let's go to this next example. Now, I have 2 over 3 here, and I have 7 over 9. Again, what do I need to do here? I want to convert this one to also towards equivalent fraction, after which I'll now decide or deduct from it. Oh, I'll now be able to decide which one is larger or which one is what? Smaller. Now, how do I go about it? The other time I changed the denominator, I made sure that the denominator are what? The same. Now, I need to start from numerator. Is there any way I can make these 2 and 7 to be the same? Or is there any way I can make this 3 and this 9 to be the same? I think I'd rather go with the denominator, which is the 3 and the what? 9. So, this 9, what can I do to this 9 and what can I do to this 3 that will make them to now have a new denominator? They will now have the same denominator at the end of the day. Since 9 is the bigger value, I can choose to say 9 multiplied by 1. Now, if I say 9 times 1, I'll still have 9 back. But what can I do to this 3? What number will I use to multiply this 3 that will make me arrive at this same 9? It is what? 3. I'll multiply with 3 because 3 times 3 will give me what? 9. So you can see that if I have 3 times 3 here, I'll get 9. 9 times 1 here, 9. That means I'll be able to change the denominator to what? The same denominator. Does that make sense? Now, I will not stop there. Whatever it is that I do to this denominator, I need to do the same to the numerator. Does that make sense? Now, I multiply this one by 3. So that means I'll go to its numerator and multiply it with the same thing that I did to the denominator. Is that making sense? Alright, that means I'll say multiply by 3. Then this one, so I multiply this by 1. That means I'll multiply this one too by 1. Is that clear? Alright. Now, what do we have here? 2 times 3 is what? 6. This one is 3 times 3 is what? 9. This is 7 times 1, 7. 9 times 1, 9. So you can see that I have been able to successfully make the denominators to be what? To be the same. Now, the fact that I have the same denominator here, the following rules that I apply here is going to apply there. Now, for me to know the bigger or the smaller fraction out of these 2 of them, I need to ask myself. They have the same denominator. And in that first rule, they say if they have the same denominator, the one that has the bigger numerator becomes the bigger or the larger fraction. Meaning that this one becomes our larger fraction. Meaning that this 7 over 9 is bigger than what? 2 over what? 3. Does that make sense? All right. So because I have 2 over 3 here, and it's not as big as this, so 2 over 3 will be what? Less than what? 7 over 9. Is that clear? All right. So thank you so very much. Let's look at let's look at 2 more examples so that you can understand better. Alright, so let's look at 2 more examples so that we can understand better. Now I have 12 over 24 and I have 1 over 2. I want to know which is bigger. Is it that this is bigger than this or this is smaller than this or they are even what equal to each other? So how do we know? Now look at their numerator, they are not the same. Look at their denominator, they are not the same. So what do? We change towards equivalent fraction. Alright. So I have 12 over 24 and then I have 1 over what? 2. So I can start from the numerator to see if I can make them equal. If I can make the 2 numerators to be the same. If not, I'll go to the denominator. So I have 12 here and I have 1 here. Is there anything I can do to make this 12 and 1 to be the same? Yes. I can say 1 times 12 will be 12. And here too, I'll say 12 times 1, which will still be what? The same. And I can decide to go to the denominator, which is 24 and 2. Now, how can I make these 2 to be the same? This, I can say 2 times 12 will give me 24. Just like 24 times 1 will still give me back what? 24. So let me just use the numerator. You can use any one. You can use either the 2 numerator or you use either the 2 denominator. Whichever one that you're comfortable with. So let me use the 2 numerator. Now I have the numerator here. I have here is what? 12. The one I have here is what? 1. So what do? I want to make them to be alike, to be the same. Do you understand? Alright, what do I do? Now I have 1 here. How can I make 1 to seem as though it is what? 12. That means I'll multiply by what? 12. Because 1 times 12 will give me what? 12. How can I make this 12 to be exactly like 12? So that means I'll multiply by what? 1. Does that make sense? So you can see that the numerator here, 12 times 1 is 12. The numerator here also is what? 12 times 1, which is what? 12. Now, whatever I do to this numerator here, I have to do to the same thing to the denominator here. So that means these 2 are multiplied by 12. This 1, 2 I multiply by what? 1. Do you understand? Alright. Now, I have 12 times 1 here is what? 12 over 24 times 1 is what? 24. So I have 12 over what? 24 here. Now, this next one here, I have 1 times 12 is what? 12 over 2 times 12 is what? 24. Now, most of the time, you can decide to just continue to break them down into their lowest term. I can decide to leave it like that, but it's advisable to break them down to their lowest term. You continue to break them down until you cannot break them any further. Do you understand? So in breaking them down, even before I start breaking them down, you can see that they have the same thing. 12 over 24, 12 over what? 24. So 12 here, 1. 12 here, 2. So this one is the same thing as was 1 over 2. The same way, this one, how many 12 can I get in 12? 1. How many 12 can I get in 24? 2. So that means I have 1 over 2. Now, if I'm going to ask you, 1 over 2 and 1 over 2, what do you think they have? Do you think this one is different from this? Do you think this is greater than this or smaller than this? I think they are the same. 1 over 2 is just the same as us, 1 over 2. So I'm going to put here what? 12 over 24 is this equal to what? 1 over 2. Does that make sense? All right. Now, let's look at this last example. Here I have 5 over 6 and I have 11 over what? 12. 5 over 6. We're going to do the same thing pretty much. There's no difference. So this one is what? 11 over 12. So if I look at the numerator, 5 and 11, is there anyone I can tweak? Or is there any number I can use to make them to what? To be the same? They should be, you know. Then I can try to use my denominator as well. I think I'm comfortable using this denominator, you know. So let me make this denominator to be what? To be the same. Now I have 12 here. This denominator here is 12 and this one is 6. So what can I do to 12 that will make this 12 to remain? And what can I do to this 6 that will make this 6 to be like what? 12. After all, you cannot change this bigger one to this smaller one, but it's easy for you to change this smaller one to what? Bigger number. Do you understand? So I'll introduce 1 here. And that's 12 times 1. This one, what will I do to this 6 to make me have this 12 here? It's 6 times 2. So I'll multiply by what? 2. So whatever I do to this denominator, I had to what? Do the same to the numerator. So since I'm multiplying the denominator here by 2, the numerator 2, I have to multiply by what? 2. Now the same way, I have multiplied the denominator here by 1. That means I have to multiply the numerator here by what? 1 as well. So here, let me come back here. 5 times 2 is what? 10. 6 times 2 is what? 12. Now here I have 11 times 1 is what? 11. 12 times 1 is what? 12. Now, so I have 10 over 12 and 11 over what? 12. So how do we know which one is larger than the other or which one is smaller than the other? So look at their numerator. They are different. But their denominator, they are what? The same. Now, if their denominator are the same, it suffices to say that since the denominator are the same, so that means the larger number here becomes a larger fraction. Does that make sense? Meaning that 11 over 12 is actually larger than what? 5 over 6. And this is what we have. Meaning that 5 over 6 is what? Less than 11 over 12. Does that make sense? Thank you so much for watching this video. I'll be expecting your questions in the comment section. Please give this video a thumbs up. Share with your friends and family. And do not forget to subscribe. Also, do not forget to smash the notification bell so that you get notified. You'll be the first to get notified anytime I upload video. Thank you, and I'll see you in the next video.